Welcome to our webinar, Psycor 8, The Good, The Great, and Getting There. My name is Mike Shaw, and I'll be your host for this webinar. Before we begin, I'm just going to go over a little bit of housekeeping tips and a little bit about Hedgehog. So, who is Hedgehog Development? Hedgehog is an end-to-end consultancy offering a range of services from design to strategy, from custom solution creation to integration assistance. We've been a Psycor partner for quite some time now, starting in 2007. And we have offices across the U.S., headquartered in New York, with offices also in Oregon and North Carolina. We have a European division, which is centered in Sofia, Bulgaria as well. Now, I'm going to hand it over to our speakers so they can introduce a little bit about themselves.
Hi, my name is Sean Holmesby. I'm a solutions architect here at Hedgehog Development. I'm a Psycor MVP, and I've been an MVP for the 2 years that I've been here at Hedgehog. And as you can probably tell by my accent, I am born as an Australian, but being here for those couple of years, I consider myself an honorary American, as evidenced by the fact there's no U in honorary in that slide.
Hey everyone, I'm Nick Stevens. I'm also a solutions architect here at Hedgehog. I've been here just about the same time as Sean, for about 2 years, 2.5 years. And as you can tell by my accent, I am an actual American. And I'm going to hand this back to Mike so he can cover the agenda for today.
Thanks, guys. So today, as you can guess it, we're going to cover upgrading. Psycor 8 is the must-have experience marketing platform. So upgrading to the version Psycor 8 and 8.1 is really a hot-button topic. So what we're going to do first is we're going to cover some of the business and technical benefits included in upgrading. Then we're going to go over what it takes to upgrade and things you need to know and prepare for. Finally, we're going to go over some tips, some tricks, and some gotchas that we've experienced over our time doing some upgrades. We'll wrap this up with the Q&A session. And please do remember to input any of your questions in the on-screen app as soon as you have them. There is a delay, so do not wait until we start Q&A to ask your questions. Now, I'll hand this over to Nick, and he'll cover the business benefits in Psycor 8.
Thanks, Mike. All right, so starting with the business benefits of Psycor 8, some of you have seen, if you've opened up a new instance of Psycor 8 or seen any of the screenshots, you'll notice that there's been a complete overhaul of the UI for the majority of the Psycor applications. They've gone down the route of making a more consistent UI, now built in Speak. On top of that, they've added a whole host of new marketing tools and testing tools for business owners. Some of those new tools that were added, we're looking at the Experience Profile, the Experience Explorer, and on the back end now, the versioned layouts, as well as the what used to be the shared source module, FXM. In addition to those tools, you'll know that in 8.1, we've introduced a whole host of new rules for the editors. Now, these are out-of-the-box rules that can be used for personalization that include things like GeoIP, which, as you know, used to be available through MaxMind and is now built into Psycor, as well as information around campaigns, channels, visits, and visitors themselves. And what we have here is the actual experience profile. Now, what this basically is a full view of a user on your website. Based on all the data that we're now tracking, due to the ability for us to use MongoDB and the amount of data that we're actually pushing into it, we're able to track a complete user's journey through our website, which basically includes all a user's actions, all their goals, and all the pages that they've actually visited throughout the site. And you can actually view that all right here for that particular user. So as you can see, we actually, if the user is signed in, we have all the details about that user, as well as all their activity, profiling, any details specifically about them, and any other additional social information that we may have.
The next feature we're looking at here is the Experience Explorer. Now, we're familiar with the Experience Editor, previously the Page Editor. This sort of, the Experience Explorer gives us a very similar view to that. Essentially what we get is the ability to mimic our website as viewed by a potential user coming to visit the website. So one mode that we have is journey mode, where we can click through our website from the home page to news to other features and articles, and just see how our website sort of transforms according to our personalization rules from their journey. Another mode is fixed mode, where, as you can see here on the left, we have the ability to sort of tick off parameters that represent what a user might have already achieved before coming to the website. So if you want to see what the website looks like when they've already triggered a campaign or done something specific or come from a specific IP, here's the place that you can actually trigger that that preset here and just see how your website moves over and adjusts accordingly. I think this is one of a very underrated feature of Sitecore 8. I think it's very cool, and it's a really, really huge benefit to marketers and content editors.
Yeah, and just to add to that, I know some of you have obviously probably seen on the Sitecore 8 launch sites, they always have that little module on the right side that follows you around. And this is basically a way for, you know, without having to install that module, an editor can actually walk through your entire site to understand what it is and what the impact that they're having by personalizing pieces of content is. What we're seeing here is the new layout details window. So when you look at the presentation details, we used to just have basically whatever the renderings were that were on that page, so the standard layout and whatever the modules or renderings or controls. Sitecore has introduced this new final layout, and they've also called out this shared layout. Basically what this is if you remember back in older versions, all layouts were basically shared across all versions and languages, which meant that any changes that you made to a presentation was reflected across all of those versions and languages. Now with this new final layout, editors have the ability to modify presentation for specific language versions, and they're also able to actually roll back changes to a presentation. So they actually have the ability to look at the current version now versus the version we had up there yesterday in terms of presentation. In addition to that, there's now the ability to actually walk through workflow with presentation details, which we never had before. And the biggest part of this is that now we actually have the ability to content test across versions for the presentation.
Cool. The next feature that we're looking at is the Federated Experience Manager, or otherwise known as FXM. This is basically a tool that allows you to drop in components on non-Sitecore sites that can be managed from within Sitecore. So say you have a third-party site, you're looking to convert it over to Sitecore eventually. What you can use this tool for is say, well, I want to get the business benefits of personalization and analytics tracking into that site already. We can drop modules in there, control the content from Sitecore, and actually control our personalization rules from there as well. Previously, this was a shared source module originally developed by Arc Systems, but now has been included as part of actually the full Sitecore platform. So the next feature is content testing. This content testing was basically available in a very rudimentary form in previous versions of Sitecore. It used to be sort of the MV testing, where we had the ability to test a component basically by swapping out a data source on a specific rendering. With that, we really could only do sort of a manual start-stop of that test, as well as really not having that many metrics behind how well that test performed. Engagement value was really the only thing we went off. Now in Sitecore 8, we've got the ability to add some different types of tests. So we've still got our component test. We've now got content tests, where we can actually test the context item fields, for example, like a title field. We can see how that performs. We can test the personalization, so we can check how our personalization rules are actually getting hit by our users. And then we have some optimization tests, where we can sort of combine content tests, personalization tests, component tests all into one. On top of that, we have a new page test feature. This one's a big one that I think a lot of people will be using. Essentially, we get to test one page versus another. We can test page A versus page B. Or we can take page A and say, hey, here's version one of page A versus version two of page A. And we can sort of test how well each version is actually working. So when we've got the ability to compare versions, we have in our UI the ability to create a new version for testing and then get those metrics back.
And one thing to note also on here, as we mentioned before, you have the ability to put this through workflow for content testing. So at the point where an editor would be saving and committing their changes into workflow, an approver would actually have the ability to, they'll get an option to say approve with test or approve without test. And what we'll see next is basically what that user will now see after they approve with a test. So what you're seeing now is basically the preview before you start a test. And as you can see here, this top part in the preview section is basically every variation that's currently enabled on this page. Right, so as Sean was saying, you have the ability to say test page A against page B. Now, within those two changes, there may be multiple variations on that page, which could include personalization, component testing. And what you're seeing here basically is a carousel outlining and showing you each section that's going to be possibly tested and changed. You have the ability also on here to sort of say what this test is, what the expectation of this test is, whether it should be going up or down in terms of engagement value. But even more powerful than this is the next part of this, which is that variables tab on top. So what you see here is actually a list of all the variables that are currently going to be tested within this test. And you'll see here that based on the previous one, that previous slide in preview, you were seeing a carousel personalization, you were seeing abstract spot personalizations. You were also seeing, as Sean had mentioned, a title tag, which was the, you know, a actual field on the context item that was actually being changed. So on here, you'll see that as home as the name and the type is a content test. So pretty cool. The editor has the ability to go through here and actually tick off which tests or which variations they want included in this test and which ones they don't. They also have the ability to change the percentage of users that are going to be exposed to this test.
So along with that, and there's a lot of features here, so we'll go through them as quickly as we can. There's some new features. Sitecore Social is an implementation of the old Sitecore Social Connected module. Essentially, this allows for single sign-on with social login, so you can log in with Facebook, Twitter, Google+, etc. We also have sort of tracking of our social media posts from within our content editor as well. We have the Path Analyzer, which allows us to trace a visitor's path, essentially figure out their journey throughout the website while sort of taking into account goals that we're looking for or segments of users that we want to view those paths by. We can then see sort of drop-off rates and things like that from that, that tool. Next up, we have the List Manager, and the List Manager basically allows for certain segmentation of your users. You can set up separate lists of users from within this tool, which can then be used in your personalization. So existing rules can select from a specific segment, so you can personalize content based on that. Or as mentioned with the Path Analyzer, you can utilize specific paths for those segments. So that's another cool feature. Next up, we have the Email Experience Manager. The email stuff has been around for a while, the old Email Campaign Manager. This has basically got a nice little facelift in Sitecore 8 up to the Speak user interface and continues to improve on its features on every iteration. And lastly, the Campaign UI, which is new in Sitecore 8.1. This essentially is a little tool that's available for campaign creation and viewing. So you can go into the Campaign Creator tool. You can easily sort of browse your campaigns. There's a whole new taxonomy behind it, but you can also create it instead of having to go to the old content editor interface to control everything from there. So next up, we're going to look at some of the tech benefits of Sitecore 8.
Some of you probably heard already, back around 7.5 and forward now into 8.1, Sitecore has made the move to now start using Mongo as its backend database for analytical data. this is sort of a big step for us in terms of, out of the box speed boosts in terms of read and write, which we obviously noticed a problem with back when we were using SQL. And on top of that, we were having, out of the box, we get the ability to have a little bit of a better scalability with replica sets out of the box versus with SQL. Couple things to note, and back in 8.1, which was technically 8.0 update 5, really, they updated to support MongoDB 3, which including Wired Tiger. And that's through the C# driver 1.10.
So with that, Wired Tiger is the new storage engine, which has been backed by Mongo. So Mongo 3.2 was released recently, and Wired Tiger became the default storage engine. So if you're just starting to use analytics and you're starting up with Sitecore either 8 or 8.1, we'd strongly suggest going towards that Wired Tiger option as your storage engine, because it's being backed in all areas of of the technical world. So another feature is the updated UI. So as we mentioned, everyone's seen the new facelift that Sitecore has had. This is using SPEAK, which stands for the Sitecore Process Enablement Acceleration Kit. I'm glad I got that one out. essentially, this is a framework that allows you to develop Sitecore applications with a consistent interface. So everything to a content editor or marketer sort of looks and feels the same. Sitecore is built off of this itself. It's a framework that you can build your own apps, and you can even extend Sitecore with your SPEAK components, I suppose. So for example, if you want to extend the Experience Explorer, Experience Editor, you'd use SPEAK to do that. Basically, you've got an out-of-the-box set of page layouts and components you can use, and you can also build your own. This replaces the old way of doing things, which used to be a XAML or Sheer UI implementation, or the old way of just calling an ASPX page, which I know a lot of developers are probably guilty of. This is a more modular approach with some better development techniques and strategies. So it's highly recommended that this should be looked at with creating Sitecore apps.
I'm sure everyone's going to miss out on building Sheer UI applications.
Yeah, it's not quite a favorite in the community. SPEAK has been around for a while. It technically made an introduction in 7.2. Now it's sort of gone through a couple of iterations, and in 8.1, SPEAK is now version 2.0. Essentially, that means that you can have, there's been a whole architecture restructuring of the SPEAK components. So if you're using SPEAK 2.0, make sure all of your components on that page of the application use 2.0. If not, you can still use the old 1.2, I think was the version beforehand. So next up, we have better dependency resolution for inversion of control. This is something that was new in Sitecore 8.1. Hopefully you're using IOC in your development, but what you may have found is you would have had to, in the past, create your own controller factories that would essentially use your dependency resolver for your controllers and your interfaces. Now in 8.1, as we can see, the difference between here, the old way in the top image and the new way in the bottom image, our Sitecore's out-of-the-box controller factory actually hits up the dependency resolver to figure out what it's trying to find. So this is a key thing to remember, that if you've got like an existing controller factory, you probably won't need it anymore. Saying that, if you're using Castle Windsor, I would be very wary about that. Maybe you should be still using your custom controller factory. And the reason for that is there's a known memory leak when releasing controllers. So please get in contact with us if you're using Castle Windsor and looking to get rid of that in 8.1.
Cool. Another feature that was added in 8.1 is the ability to define areas. And as many of you know who have used MVC with Sitecore, this was never really an option. And you typically had to either define your own solution on the back end, and that could either be by hard coding in your full controller paths or view paths, or adding tokens. Now, on top of that, we actually have the ability in Sitecore to add in the areas here. So you'll see that on the layout field or on the rendering fields, on the rendering components, you actually have the ability to define that area. Now that goes based on their processor, they have the ability to do this at a granular level, like I said, at a rendering, all the way up to the layout for the entire section. On top of that, I think one of the other modules that you may have used was probably the BraidJox module, which also added a custom template for those layout folders and rendering folders, which you would also define an area there.
Yeah, I think BraidJox implementation of areas was a common one used throughout the community, and I think there are a couple of implementations out there that other people had used. I think the key feature to understand with 8.1 is that it is customizable, as with the rest of Sitecore. So there's a pipeline that you can use to say, how do you resolve your areas? Now, as Nick mentioned, out of the box, there's a couple of different granularity levels already out of the box there for you. But if you wanted to implement your own or re-architect the way that it works to use similar to what BraidJox or any of those other modules had previously done, you can still do that. And I think that's a really cool feature and sort of very Sitecore-esque to allow that that extensibility. So some other cool stuff. We've got in 8.1, cold startup has been improved. So a lot of people know that it took a while to start up. Performance in general has just improved in 8.1. Part of that is from Speak, where, as mentioned before, 2.0 has sort of been re-architected a bit. Components now are a bit more streamlined and load a bit quicker. So in general, we should notice a big update in the performance of out-of-the-box Sitecore controls, as well as any of your own custom ones written in Speak.
Yeah, and then on top of that, we also have Sitecore using the latest version of MVC Razor. So we get those Razor performance improvements. On top of that, it also, and this is in 8.1 only, it reintroduces the personalization without analytics, which would be considered the CMS-only mode. Prior to this, this was available in 7.5, but then overlooked in 8. So if you are one of the clients that are using CMS-only mode for personalization, then you would probably want to target either 7.5 or 8.1.
Yeah, and also sort of not mentioned here as well is some updates from the web API point of view. So sitecore.services.client is now implemented in 8.0. This is sort of, I think it's sort of going to be sort of a replacement of the item web API. I haven't dived too deep into it. I know it's there. It's available for all developers to use. And I think it's mainly used within the Speak apps, which is pretty cool. And another feature that we haven't mentioned here in 8.1 was the language fallback. Previously, again, another shared source module that was out there on the marketplace that has now been rolled into the platform.
All right. So we'll take a look now at sort of what you need to know when you're planning on getting there to upgrade Sitecore. So what we need to prepare for and basically what it takes. So first and foremost, as we mentioned, really testing and practice. We need to be able to plan for who's going to be testing the site. Basically, all your editors or developers, everyone really needs to test basically from the ground up on changes that we're making. We also need to, and what we typically do is basically prepare on lower environments. So typically either a local instance with backup content or dev instance with the latest version of that cycle that you're targeting, just to make sure that you know what you're getting yourself into before you get up to production.
Yeah, I think knowing your Sitecore version is a huge thing as well, because you want to know what these config changes are. I think that allows for you to sort of pick up better knowledge of where you can extend the platform from now on. It also gives you some insight into how the new features work, and you might find some things that will help you down the road. You should also know things about the upgrade path. So what database scripts do I need to run? What versions are we actually jumping between? What are the third-party tools and things like that that we will need to update? So understanding the Sitecore version that you're going to and possibly all the versions in between can be very beneficial in your upgrade. Next up, we have customization. So when you're customizing Sitecore, you've sort of got your own code, and then you're trying to do an upgrade, and the Sitecore upgrade doesn't know anything about your own code. So you want to make sure that your customizations are going to be compatible once you upgrade. An example of this might be if you've updated the page editor ribbon before. You would have created a button on the ribbon that used to use a command and then call your own custom code. Now, because the page editor has been changed to use Speak, you're going to have to upgrade that component, that customization, to use a Speak component instead. Things like this, things like in 7.1, the rules taxonomy changed. So rules will need to be upgraded. We need to know these things to know how to sort of keep our customizations working in the future upgrade.
Sure, and one other thing to note really is that there's integrations that you currently have that need to persist in the new version. Those should be listed out and prepared for as well. So we're talking about integrations with existing CRMs, any external custom applications that you've brought into Sitecore. So, and this goes really for clients that are, you know, using multiple applications and really trying to focus an editor's perspective in Sitecore. So they would build a client-side app inside of Sitecore. On top of that, we want to look at, you know, shared source modules. There's been a lot of shared source modules that will either no longer exist now because they've actually been integrated into Sitecore. So you need to be aware of any customizations you've done with those modules and how those are now changing or being affected, as well as any versions of shared source modules that are now deprecated or not available yet in the targeted version that you're looking for.
So next up, we're going to look at what it takes to upgrade Sitecore to Sitecore 8. Now, Sitecore 8 is a big step forward from Sitecore version. So one of the key things that we always figure out is we need to go through a whole planning phase.
Right. So what we're really dealing with here is we want to talk to our clients, and internally we discuss this. You know, we need to have a fully documented plan in place before we even start that upgrade. So this is creating a strategy, basically, after, you know, doing your practice tests on a lower environment, and making sure you account for all your solution-specific modifications and integrations. In terms of planning as well, you want to start planning for things like possible downtimes or content freezes.
So when we come to downtime planning, this could be taken in different sorts of ways, right? Can the website actually come down? Or do we need sort of downtime from other people working on the system while it's still up? Right. Downtime planning, from our point of view, can be something you determine with the client beforehand, where if it's a small website, maybe, you know, at 3 a.m. overnight on a weekend or something, we can take it down. Right? But if we have a large website, large customer base, and there's absolutely zero, no downtime of the front-end website, that needs to be taken into account as well. Can the client actually afford the downtime? What does downtime actually mean from the client? Is it front-end downtime? Is it content management downtime? Figure these sorts of things out in the planning phase. So with that, content freeze. And this is essentially content management downtime. If you are doing an upgrade, you might need to tell your client, well, at a certain point, we need to actually do a content freeze. We can't have anyone updating items within Sitecore because maybe we're switching over our solution. Maybe we're actually updating it directly on the server. This sort of stuff is something that you'd prepare a content freeze for. And so you need to sort of plan that and be prepared for that scenario. And so if you do a content freeze, content migration might be something you don't need to worry about, right? Depending on your setup, you could have a scenario where you say, all right, content freeze. Now we're going to go and update that database. Or what you could do for content migration is say, we're going to take a snapshot of the database. We're going to continue letting our content editors go in and make updates. We are offline going to upgrade that database, upgrade our code, make sure everything's working. And then when we're ready to go live, we're going to put it on a server and switch over our load balancer to make sure it's in production. Now, if you do that, the time that you've got from when you said you took the snapshot and to the time that you've got your content editors actually using the new instance, there might be a need for migrating the content over that they updated in that period. So here's a sort of planning thing, right? Because if you've got your content freeze, your content migration, we really need to know how this is going to play out. And this could change with your infrastructure as well. So when you're doing content migration like this, we commonly use Razzle, our database compare tool, and you can use Razzle's history view to be able to migrate those changes over. So you can just tell what is the latest updated content.
Okay, and then one of the most hotly debated questions, can you actually, can content be migrated directly from, say, an old version of 7 to 8.1 directly? I think this is probably Sean's favorite question.
Yeah. This one got a bit of traction in the community fairly recently. Essentially, the upgrade, the traditional upgrade path, can be long and tiresome and lots of steps. So people just said, "Well, what about if I just go a fresh version? Can that work?" The answer is yes, but be very careful with it, right? Typically, we don't try to go down this path because of the fact that each of those upgrade steps can make modifications to your site core items. This is just one of the features. This is something that we know happens. So when you upgrade from a fresh instance, from an existing instance and content, copy all your content over to a new instance, you might miss those updates to items. So for example, when going from 7.0 to 7.1, the rules items in Sitecore change the taxonomy. So there's a new system for rules, items got moved around, items got deleted, items got edited, and essentially they were going to then be updated to work in the new version. If you did a copy over, they wouldn't be in the new place. They wouldn't be updated with the new content. They wouldn't be in that new location that works with the new system. So we want to be very careful about saying we can do that, because if we've got our custom rules, they're not going to get updated. And so features of Sitecore and of your own customizations might break if you do that. With this sort of process, we've come across different applications of it. And one thing I'd like to shout out to Mike Edwards, he did a fantastic blog post on his Glass Mapper website, which went through an upgrade process that allows you to get the database upgrades of those items, but it sort of separates it out so you can keep your code updates separate. I think that was a great post. It sort of covered both bases, allows sort of a bit of a speed up, but doesn't do a straight migration. But we would say with the update, cutting corners can be very risky. If you don't know what you're doing, and you might even think you know what you're doing, but you actually miss a step, or there might be something that you didn't quite know, it can be very risky and things might break in your new version. So yeah, that's one I like to get the boxing gloves on for.
So other things to plan for, really, infrastructure changes. Now, obviously, with Mongo, if you're planning on using Mongo for the analytics for XDB, that will probably incur some infrastructure change for you. So we need to discuss with our clients, we need to discuss with each other what is the goal and what are the infrastructure that we're moving to. You know, we have now also more indexes, a larger load on indexing in general, and you may need dedicated indexing servers for things like Solr, or if you're using Coveo or the cloud. So there are certain considerations that need to be taken into account in terms of, will we need new hardware, or will we need to procure new hardware for Sitecore itself? Just keeping in mind that older versions of Sitecore, if you're, say, on 6.6 or 7, the minimum requirements, minimum system requirements, have changed from there to 8.1. So taking a look at what your targeted version, again, so knowing your version and knowing what the hardware requirements are, will also help you plan for what hardware you're going to need in your infrastructure.
Cool. So as we mentioned before, know the new version that you're going to. In particular, web config updates. As mentioned before, we think this is a great way for you to learn more about the new version you're going to. The config updates will be required. And in particular, things might get moved from one location to another. They might get renamed. So you need to make sure that all of your customizations also reflect those changes.
So really the question is, what about my custom configs?
What about your custom configs, Nick? So the custom configs, everyone knows that we should be developing within configuration patch include files. You want to make your configuration changes in there, but we've all come across projects where we've still got things changed directly in the web config. So let's make sure we can move those out. One thing that we like to use is the Hedgehog config compare tool we use internally. So within our own labs, we've got this tool that we can sort of compare a fresh web config version versus our existing one and pluck out the patches that could create a patch config file for us.
One also thing to note, when upgrading to 8.1, you'll know that the Sitecore configuration section has now been moved out of the web config, which is a big yay. We were actually getting, you know, prior to 8.1, we were getting towards the maximum size of the web config, as you may know. So this is a big step in the right direction in terms of patching and sort of cleaning up the existing web config.
Yeah, I've seen some funny ways of getting around that, like replacing two spaces to one is a way to sort of reduce that size of the web config file. the last thing we'd like to sort of mention is if you use SIM, there's a Sitecore Instance Manager, one of the features that is in that and also comes as a standalone feature is the config builder tool. Essentially, you can point this at your website, point to the web config. It will go and take your patch config files and basically implement an XML version of the showconfig.aspx page. This is great for even just general development to say, am I patching it correctly? You don't need to load Sitecore. You just point it. It figures it out and shows you your essentially your show config. So this is a great tool to figure out if your patches are working correctly. So we mentioned before customizations to Sitecore. In particular, watch out for pipeline steps that you've customized. Things get moved. Things get updated in these configs. That's why looking at these configs can be so beneficial. Once you know what's been added to specific pipelines in specific places, you can tell if your stuff needs to get moved as well. So watch out for your customizations there.
And one other thing to note, if you've ever done any Sitecore support packages, so any changes that you may have gotten as hotfixes or directly from Sitecore, or if you've done any upgrade hotfix steps along the way, you need to be aware of what you've actually done to your instances so that you're aware of whether or not those are now included in future releases of Sitecore. So just to be aware of the Sitecore support packages that you currently have in your version.
Yeah, you can just about imagine that you've got a custom pipeline that implements the patch that then updates in Sitecore that also implements the patch and you're doing double the work. You don't want that to happen.
Yep. So on to our tips, tricks, and gotchas for Sitecore upgrades.
So as mentioned earlier, the dependency injection stuff is something that I've been looking a bit into lately. We found that with dependency injection, a lot of people go and implement their own dependency resolvers and they set the MVC resolver directly, right? So I use Ninject, I use AutoFact, I use Castle Windsor. I'm going to set ASP.NET MVC's dependency resolver to my custom resolver. The problem with this is Sitecore is already using that resolver. They're using their own sort of resolution to figure out which controllers they're using, which implementation of interfaces they're using. And as soon as we set our own, we break their stuff. Right? So if you're on Sitecore 8 and you're doing this currently, strong recommendation, open up the list manager. If you see that Spinner is currently running and it never finishes, then you've probably broken the dependency injection there. One thing we've got is sort of a chain dependency resolver. So we say, okay, whatever was the dependency resolver before, I'll take that. And whatever I want it to be, I'll take that. And if I can't resolve it, then fall back to whatever it was before and resolve it. In this case, Sitecore, and in this case, our list manager continues to work. Other things like that handles both MVC and web API. So be aware of that. And we've got some links at the end to sort of direct you in the right location for that. Next up, the Experience Explorer. Be aware that it can be a little bit tricky sometimes to figure out which site you're actually looking at for multi-site. Now, this could be dependent on your own local setup, could be dependent on configurations, but you want to just test that stuff out to see, will your site correctly resolve when using the Explorer and Page Editor and things alike? when you're using a multi-site setup in SiteCore. For image resizing, the old way used to be you just append onto your image URL a question mark W equals 80 and H equals 100, and bang, there's my miraculously resized server-side image coming back to me. This no longer works as of an update from 7.5 and possibly being backported to earlier versions of SiteCore. Now, there's if you're doing that explicit concatenation of a string, you might need an extra hash on the end. However, you should just continue using SiteCore's API to be able to pull in that hash. If you don't use this hash and you don't do that resize correctly, you're going to be pulling down the actual full-size versions of those images, which you might resize client-side, but if that happens, well, your page size is going to bloat. So be very aware of that. Your image sizes might change if you haven't implemented this correctly. Again, content migration risk. We mentioned all the stuff about migrating content from one version to another. If you update that stuff, that's fine. If you know what you're doing, it's fine. If you don't update it, it might not be compatible with the new version of SiteCore. So be aware of that.
And that last part here is basically, use the third-party NuGet packages that SiteCore is currently using. One thing that comes to mind that we always seem to run into is really JSON.NET. Typically, we always want to use the latest version. However, SiteCore or the version of SiteCore that we're using may still be using an older version of it. So whenever we do a project and we build out, you'll have a conflict of, the DLL that SiteCore needs is now upgraded and no longer available. So typically, we like to rely on saying use the package versions that SiteCore is using, which will avoid having to update your dependencies for those.
Yeah, I figure that's the safest option. You don't want to risk moving to a different version unless you need to. Like, unless you've actually got a use case that you need a new Newtonsoft package, well, what is that use case? And what is the potential that could break SiteCore's out-of-the-box stuff from doing that? I think, with these points, these are just some of the main points that we've sort of caught along the way. But keep in mind that there are so many things that could be potentially wrong with upgrades, like things that you want to check and double check. No two upgrades are the same. So this stuff, dependency injection might not be an issue in one environment. It might be on a different site. So be aware that there's so many things that should be worried about and things that you should be concerned about when upgrading, but understand it can be done. It just needs to be done with a careful sort of precision manner in which upgrades should be executed.
So here you're going to have a list of our resources, some of the links that basically can help you out with upgrading.
Cool. So the first one I mentioned earlier was Mike Edwards' link to upgrading a SiteCore website. I think that's an absolutely fantastic blog post. It details some of the issues of ways that other people have done it in the past and sort of come up with a very streamlined, very smooth, very elegant way of upgrading.
I'll let you talk about this. There was this other blog post about the truth about SiteCore upgrades by some guy named Sean Holmesby. It's pretty good, and I guess I won't say much about that one.
Next up, we have SiteCore upgrades from Mark Stiles, a very, very funny blog post. I highly recommend you read it about three times because he goes off on some funny little anecdotes. And be sure when you look at that website to hover over all of the links because his tooltips are fantastic.
And then, of course, now we're just getting out of hand because there's obviously two more here by someone named John Holsby. One is the safe dependency injection, which Sean covered before for both MVC and Web API. And also the same issue with images not resizing in SiteCore 7.5 and up.
Yep, and all of these resources will be linked below, so you will be able to get them at any time. Sweet. So if you're interested in learning more about upgrades, we have a white paper available at the URL you see on the screen. Additionally, Hedgehog offers services around upgrades. In addition to just an upgrade service, we have an assessment service, which gives companies a general idea about how difficult an effort would be to upgrade, what headaches you need to look out for. This is really just a great package for companies that are looking to upgrade but don't really know what that effort looks like yet. So if you're interested in that, you could also find that at the URL on screen. If you'd like to get in touch with me, Sean, or Nick, our contact information is on screen as well. We're happy to chat about anything you might have afterwards. So with that, I'd like to thank everyone and open the floor up for some questions. Wonderful. So the first question I have here is on the Experience Explorer. How extensible is Experience Explorer?
From an extensibility point of view, we've cracked it open. We've had a bit of a look at what can be done in it. It might take a bit of work to implement sort of your own custom attributes into it, which would be very handy because you've got your custom rules that query those attributes. But at the moment, I haven't specifically extended it, but I can see potential for it in there.
Okay. So we talked a lot about Sitecore 8 and 8.1. What's the biggest difference in a jump between 8 and 8.1? And if you had to talk about a version you'd upgrade to, is there any difference?
Yeah, I think for me personally, I'd go to 8.1. 8.1 was touted as sort of the most tested platform available out there, the most tested of all the Sitecore releases previously. Lots of bug fixes, lots of performance improvements. Feature-wise, we've now started to sort of dive into these brand new features that we're really fine-tuning. So Path Analyzer has become more usable because we're now utilizing it in a way that actual marketers have complained about in the past to say, hey, I want to split this on better segments, better goals, better outcomes, better channels, and get a more detailed view on Path Analyzer. Same too with Experience Explorer. Now, because we've gone down that path of like versioning of the rendering of the final renderings field, now we have the ability to go into the Experience Editor and say, hey, well, if this is shared, I want to edit only the shared stuff. Or if this is only specific for this version, let's only edit that. And Sitecore has gone to the lengths to sort of say, well, we made those changes, now we're going to update those tools to sort of make them usable and make them more workable.
Cool. Okay, so the next question we have here is on the Speak and Share UI stuff. If, talked a lot about Speak in the webinar, if we had some Share UI apps, or let's say I was a developer that I was really invested in the Share UI, does Share not work in Sitecore 8? Am I prevented from developing Share UI apps?
No, I think the concern here is probably that I'm used to Share. I know how it works. I don't know what this Speak thing is. And it's a valid concern, right? If you've got a quick app that you need to create for a client, you need to roll that out quickly, you probably do it the way you know. And that's probably what has been the fallback in the past of using ASPX pages, right? Quick call to an ASPX page because it's code like a web page that I've used before and I know how to do it. Share UI is not completely outdated. It's not disabled in Sitecore 8. You can still use it. There's even still configuration options where you can switch off entire Speak interfaces and still use the existing Share interfaces. So it is still possible, but we would highly recommend that developers start looking at this Speak stuff, figuring out how it works, and becoming accustomed to Speak the same way that they had previously been accustomed to Share UI. Development in general is a constantly moving thing, so we should always be trying to keep up and looking at these new things. We want to learn these new things, and we don't really want to be stuck in our old ways. So it's a smart thing to do. Look at the tutorials, look at the blog posts, and at least start to see how this all works.
Okay. So next we have here on 8.1. How is the load time with pre-compilation of Speak in 8.1? Like, what are startup times have you tuned up to? Do you have any performance recommendations for 8.1 or 8.0 development?
So, as mentioned earlier, 8.1 already is a bit quicker than 8. Speak itself has been improved. However, there are various things out there already that developers have found to say, hey, you know what, for local development, I can sort of bypass certain things like pre-compilation of Speak views and things. So you know what, I don't need to reload those every time I load Sitecore. I only need them when I need them. So you can check online, you can find sort of, what are they, patch config files where pre-compilations can be disabled. On top of that, you can sort of modify the page editor and say where, what are the performance issues with page editor? One, for example, is the my locked items count. So that was using FastQuery. Someone's gone and written a blog post about how we can update that to use Lucene content search if we want. That could be improved performance-wise that way. And on top of that, you know, one thing I like to use is, I think it was Alan Pellin from Sitecore actually released a gist. He released a gist on the Sitecore initialized pipeline, where essentially it's going to run the pipeline from a thread. So this means that the startup time can be improved just by that customization. Again, probably something you'd only want sort of in your development environments. But in general, this sort of stuff can be tuned within with production environments as well.
Awesome. Now I have a question here about what we covered. What out of all the things you've covered here today, what is your gut feeling on what you think the most common issue a developer or a company runs into when upgrading? Out of all the things you said to watch out for.
Again, because every upgrade is different, that's a sort of tough question to answer. Again, all websites are different. All customizations are different. One thing I am constantly coming across, and maybe this is just because I keep diving deeper into this dependency injection, the IOC realm, the big one I keep seeing is that people are overriding the dependency resolver. And the funny thing there is that their customization works for them, and it takes them a while to find out that actually a Sitecore component is broken. And that sort of rolls into, make sure that, you know, your customizations of the website aren't also broken in this upgrade, but also Sitecore out of the box isn't.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think that's sort of the biggest part, really. It's your custom configuration, your custom changes conflicting with something that could be broken or isn't broken already by something else that you're upgrading.
Great. Got some more here. We have a few more minutes, so we'll add to them. Other than MongoLab, do you have any recommendations on MongoDB hosting that's out there?
So I haven't looked deep into MongoLab, but I think I understand the question's direction there. Is essentially you can do sort of on-premises Mongo hosting if you'd like, if you have that ability. Then you start to go into sort of realms of the cloud-based XDB. So Sitecore out of the box have the XDB cloud offering. So if you want to say, hey, Sitecore, you host this, you sort of worry about all those infrastructure issues and things like that, I'll opt for that option. I'll pay for that as my way of hosting Mongo. Another one is Rackspace. Rackspace has introduced an offering called Object Rocket. Again, another cloud-based solution, which you don't need to worry about. You just say, hey, here's Object Rocket. Here are my details. And you worry about hosting. You get your analytics hosted in the cloud, you get that all set up, and can definitely save in infrastructure costs and even maintenance, I suppose, because it falls to the other end, not your end.
Depending upon the size.
Yeah.
And the network traffic.
Yeah. And those offerings, you'll need to speak to each of those companies separately to find out the different offerings. Small sites might be able to get away with sort of on-premises. You might even be able to get away with minimal amounts of servers. If you move to cloud-based offerings, then that can sort of scale up as well. So I'd say there are a few options out there, and MongoLab is one of them, but also consider, you know, Sitecore, consider Rackspace as well.
Got another one here. If you upgrade to 8.1, will you still be able to use your custom Sitecore.aspx pages you've already built, or do you recommend you transform all of them to Speak?
So I think this is sort of talking towards custom applications, using custom Sitecore ASPX pages in custom applications. I think it depends on the scenario. You might need to look into the configurations to see where speakers enabled. And this goes back to the question before, do we need to upgrade from Sheer UI to Speak? If you want to disable Speak, you might be able to then use your ASPX pages in the exact same way you've done before. But I haven't really looked deep into that personally. I don't know.
I mean, out of the box, they definitely still work. It's just a matter of how much integration are you looking for? Really, are you looking to integrate them on your dashboard for editors to use, or are they available sort of like an ASPX page, like in the admin section? You know, a standard just link to it from an editor. So I think it's going to be a case by case basis, and how integrated you want them to be.
And I suppose that's a thing. Like, if it's just a link to an ASPX page, there could be security concerns around it, which is why there were sort of ways to get around it. But that's why people didn't want to go down that path in the past. But if you want to do that, then I suppose that's still fine.
Mm-hmm. Great. And I think that's all the time we have today. So I want to thank Sean and Nick for taking the time today. Thank everyone who were able to join us. Again, if you have any questions, please do feel free to reach out to us. We'd love to chat about this kind of stuff. Thanks again, everyone, and have a nice day.